out there attending to Patty's knee. She's had it restrapped, making sure that she can't damage whatever the injury is any further.
Now Patty bending down to see if she can still move, make sure the bandage is not too tight. Jill Gressley able to come out for a 3-minute injury timeout, but Patty Fendick taking it on the changeover, so add a minute and a half to that for the changeover, so she has 4.5 minutes to fix up that knee.
You'll have gathered from that scoreline that Patty Fendick has really turned this match around. She's up 5-2. It's just one break of serve in the second set. We look again at her coach, Scott McCain. And the real story of this second set, the first four games went with serve. Mary Jo was holding very comfortably. Indeed, she held her first two service games to love. But then she dropped her serve in the sixth game. Fendick has just held. Statistics, Fendick's percentage of first serves, that's good. They're both good. Fendick, though, has been really spinning it in. But look at that. Look at the unforced errors. 25 unforced errors.
I just got a note here now that Patty Fendick has tendonitis of the knee. Something that she's been dealing with for a while, a couple of months.
That, I'm sure, goes a long way towards explaining why we've been surprised by Fendick's tactical approach to this match. She's a natural serve and volleyer, and she's been playing from the baseline, which is meat and drink to Mary Jo Fernandez. But if you're in pain, it's tough to come forward all the time.
Well, at the net, you make a lot more direction changes, quick stops and starts, whereas the backcourt, you're having long strides, much smoother strides in the backcourt. So maybe that's why she's not coming to the net, because usually she loves, and she's so scrappy and perky up at the net, bubbly up there, attacking.
But she's ahead, 5-2, and Fernandez is serving to stay in the second set. So here we are, here's our little perch out on the grandstand, tucked under the little awning and next to the restaurant. Maybe we'll send out for some lunch in a minute. It's a cozy little spot. It's an intimate spot. We're so close to the court. That's what I love about out here. Don't think Mary Jo Fernandez is loving the situation at the moment. Fendick really winding up the big forehands. Maybe she feels the quicker I can win this set and get into the third, the better it'll be for my knee.
That's what's really seemed to improve in the second half of the second set. Patty going for those forehands and coming up with more winners. Really putting a lot of racket head speed through the ball.
Joe advancing. Now our excellent spies down at courtside have given us a little bit more information that Mary Joe's had some painkillers at the changeover, so maybe she's not feeling too good either.
Anti-inflammatories. That would be tough for me to take during a match. Those seem to make me slower, step slower, make me a little more drowsy. A lot of players take them right before they go on court if they're having an injury problem. I'd rather feel the pain than feel slow.
Deciding it's time to press forward.
And that was when Mary Jo was having her best results midsummer last year after the finals of the French Open, lost to Steffi Graf 6-4 in the third, was when she started to play more aggressively, take advantage of those short shots and those hard ground strokes of hers and finish the point off at net. She volleys very well.
Nice wrong-footing shot. Brings up set point for Fendick.
Paddy Fendick loves that inside-out forehand with a lot of topspin. This backhand lands right near the line. Very deep in the court to come up with such a big angle, David. Impressive shot. In trouble. It's one set all. Lots more to come on day three here at the Open.
Duckman's been nominated for an Emmy.
Yippee!
And television will never...
4-5 down, and it's now 15 all.
Mary Jo Fernandez losing the first point, hitting the backhand long over the baseline. Same for Paddy Fendick, the second point. So 15 all.
Just joining us on USA, David Mercer and Tracy Austin here with you on the grandstand court. The match that's now lasted 3 minutes short of 2 hours. First set to Fernandez, 6-2. Fendick took the second by the same score.
Letting the ball play her on that one, let it drop down lower, didn't attack it.
It's been so many club players and park players do, they let the ball come to them instead of trying to take the ball on the rise and get your body weight going through the ball. You hit the ball much more crisply that way.
Backhand where she just guided. It was a good serve from Mary Jo, but she didn't. Paddy Fendick didn't hit that backhand with authority. Probably because she's up 5-4 in the third, going for an upset.
It's certainly Fernandez who's holding serve much more easily at the moment. And the benefit of that for Mary Jo is that she's still comparatively fresh. The grandstand are having a ball. We're all having a ball. It's the outstanding women's match of the US Open so far here on day three. Mary Jo Fernandez, the ninth seed, against this lady, Paddy Fendick, who leads 6-5 in the final set. And for a second time, Fernandez has to serve to save the match and try and force a tiebreak. Match can give us now.
Got everything. That one had just enough pace and enough topspin to dribble over the net.
I should think Mary Jo is very pleased that this is at the US Open, because it's the only one of the four grandstands that plays a final set tiebreak. The other three, we'd be looking at a long advantage set. The other three, we go down the wire, whether it's 10-8 or 14-12 or 26-24.
Solomon in the hat there. Mary Jo had plenty of time to come up with that backhand passing shot. Bent her knees down so low. Down for that shot.
Fendick again going to the chair. Perhaps the bandage. Scott McCain, head coach. What on earth are the emotions of the two coaches? This is a great match. A final set tiebreak to decide it.
Excuse me. Patty Fendick putting in a few stringalings. She uses gut. She strings it at 61 pounds. And what the stringalings do, you put them in between the two cross strings. So then there's not as much friction and the string won't break.
Here's their tiebreak records. Mary Jo's the more impressive. But I tell you, whoever wins this tiebreak, whoever wins this match, the real winner out here today so far has been women's tennis. This has been a great advertisement. Devonshire Park, Eastbourne. Their other meeting was in the Australian Open, Flinders Park, Melbourne. Nervy, anxious moments. Fernandez has now moved ahead in the total of points won, 93 to 89, because of course in the last few games she's held serve easily. Fendick's really struggled. Now that's the glory of the scoring system of tennis. It's a series of crises. The end of each game, the end of each set, and of course, now in a final set tiebreak. Jimmy Van Allen, the man from Newport, Rhode Island, who invented the tiebreak, I think he'll be smiling from on high.
Patty Fendick, her second air in the tiebreak on that forehand side. Again, we see her pulling her upper part of her body up when she strikes the ball and pulling away from the ball. Bit of nerves.
Just waiting while a spare ball is cleared from the corner of the court. Forehand from Fendick from so deep, Fernandez expecting a short ball had moved in.
Yeah, Fernandez got caught in no person's land, no man's land. And Patty's shot was so deep, and she really did well to not take her eye off the ball and look at what Fernandez was doing on the other side. Just hit her shot.
Point high up above the courts as we come down rackets, restaurant people enjoying the tennis, having a spot of lunch. I think you and I will have deserved a spot of lunch after this match.
2 hour and 14 minute mark now. Already mentioned it's not a sunny day, it's not extremely hot, but it is very humid.
Good serve, it hurried through. Fendick was late.
Really seemed to skip through. Change sides after 6 points. Mary Jo has one more serve.
This is when any sport becomes great. They've been going at it for 2.25 hours. You know that in the next 2 or 3 minutes, one's going to win, but you haven't got a clue who it's going to be.
That's what's great about tennis, no matter how far behind you are, how close it is. There's no time clock. You can always come back.
One set all, six games all, and 3 points all after 2.25 hours. Two good first serves.
Mary Jo continues to win her serve so easily, even in the tiebreak. Fendick not able to return either of those serves.
When the going gets tough, the tough get going. No, not that time. She had it covered. She went for too much.
This one, each shot becomes so key. So many opportunities at each point. Trying to pick the perfect opportunity to go for your big shot.
5-4. Fernandez has two serves. She came up with two really good first serves the last time she had two service points. Does that again? The match is hers.
Gives her two match points.
And Fendick turned and looked and said, what are you doing there? Great win, and a wonderful match, and the smile, and look at that.
Good friend, sign of a true champion, Mary Jo Fernandez, able to raise the level of her game when it was most important.
And how lovely that they both, at the end of it, knew they'd played a great match, and they deserved that standing ovation. Whoa, how do we follow that? I'll tell you how we follow that. With Pete Sampras, the best men's player in the world. We'll be back.
Whole match, and then the last 2 points, serve and volley. What were you thinking?
I think I wasn't thinking. That's why I did it. You know, it's a tiebreak in the third set. It's nerve-wracking. It's a lot of stress out there. And I just figured, you know, I'd been serving pretty well to her backhand, and she's, you know, she's chipping in return. I said, you know, bigger point, you know, it was the biggest point of the match right there. I said, I just got to go for it. And she passes me, it's just too good. But I didn't want to take a chance in the back. She was hitting the ball really well from the baseline, moving me around. So I went for it, and it paid off.
Yeah. Now, you were up a set and 2-all in the second set, and then the momentum seemed to switch around. What happened there?
It really did. Seemed like I was in control of the match, and I had a couple points to go up 3-2, and it looked like everything was, you know, okay. And then all of a sudden, you know, she plays a good game to break me at 4-2, and the match just turns around. She got more confident. I thought she was hitting her backhand really well, because usually she just chips in, and she was hitting, you know, high loopers into my backhand, and it was working well. And she has a really good forehand, very quick around the court, so she played well. In the third set, I thought it was a pretty good set of tennis. It really came down the wire, and anything could have happened at the end.
Now, were you surprised that Patty didn't come in much? Because usually she serves and volleys and comes to the net more.
I was a little bit, but I played her, I think, once or twice before, where she's come in a lot, and I think I passed pretty well against her. I like her shots, the ones she comes in on. So I think she tried a different tactic, and it really worked well.
And looking back a year, last U.S. Open, you weren't able to play, and then after about a month later, you had to have surgery. Mm-hmm. How's this last year been for you?
It's been very frustrating and discouraging, because I was playing well this time last year, and really thought I had made a good breakthrough and started, you know, compete well against the top players, and I had, you know, time off, and this year has been really a bit of a roller coaster health-wise. You know, I feel well a couple weeks, and I don't feel so well. But, you know, last month I've been feeling pretty healthy, and I think it's brought more excitement in my game. I'm happy to be out there now and really feel very fortunate to be playing this sport. So I think that, you know, has taken some of the pressure off and just really content to be playing.
Harold said he had gotten you to get more attacking, come into the net more just before you had the surgery.
Right.
And he said you basically had to go back to ground zero. Did you feel that way?
It was pretty much starting all over again. You know, for a baseliner like myself, it's so many years of doing the same thing, and it's really just ingrained in my mind that that's the way I play. And it took a lot to change that. And then I think when you don't play for a while, you always go back to what you know best. And that's, you know, what I know best is playing a little bit more defensive than I should. And nowadays, the girls are hitting the ball way too hard and going for it too much to play that way. So, you know, I have to get back that mentality.
Well, you attacked today when it was most important. Well done today.
Thanks, Tracy.
Back to you, John.
Okay, thanks very much, Tracy Austin and Mary Jo Fernandez. Mary Jo will play the winner of Ann Grossman and Katarina Maleva next. And when you look at her part of the draw, Mary Jo would face Arantxa Sanchez Vicario in the round of 16. Sanchez Vicario next up on the grandstand against Natalie Tauziat. 16-seeded Amy Frazier, that's the first time she's been seeded here at the Open. She now becomes the third woman seed to fall against Natalie Medvedeva. In three sets, this is match point.
59.
Medvedeva won it 6-4 in the third. Out on court five, Ginger Helgeson was a winner against Asa Carlson, 6-1, 6-1. And Isabel Dimongeau, a qualifier here, won in the third set, 6-2. She'll play the winner of Meredith McGrath and Gabriela Sabatini. Right now, let's go out to the stadium court for Pete Sampras and announcers Bill McAtee and John McEnroe.
All right, John, thanks. Here's Linda Pence.
I bought this dress on the first floor of the store.
The stadium court, that's the grandstand court to the left. And our score here on stadium court.
We've got two players looking very athletic, particularly Arantxa Sanchez Vicario on the far end. You know, it's become a pleasure to watch Arantxa even playing as well and winning as comfortably as she is today, because she takes these early rounds when she's ahead to try every aspect of her game. And to my mind, she's really becoming almost the most complete player on the women's tour. She has been really sensational throughout this match. She's just having the first little hiccup in this game here. She was love 40, then got to deuce with a sensational backhand volley, and now she's break point down again. She's up 4-3 in the second set, and that's with a break. And because she's become so dominant, she runs everything down. There's almost no way you can hit a clean winner against Arantxa these days, because she hustles so well. and Natalie Tauziat, her opponent, hasn't really been able to take advantage of the chances that she's had. Just a little edginess creeping into her game, and you can understand why when she won the first set very comfortably. There's always one little patch in the second set, I think, when the players tighten up. Natalie Tauziat from a fantastically beautiful part of France, Bayonne, has been ranked as high as number 11 in the world 2 years ago, but it's down at 27. And what happens is that you lose your seeding position in tournaments, and then you meet better players earlier on, and gradually you lose confidence. So not as good a year for her. She managed to get one away from Arantxa. In the middle of the screen is her mother, Marissa, always watching. Her coach was there, Gabriela. Fifth break point. There for Tauziat to come back and even the set up at four. Trouble. You know, this is the first time that she's got, well, the second time actually, that she's even got to a six-all situation against Tauziat. She's always beaten her in straight sets. You see, Arantxa's always consistent on the first serve. She's actually been hitting some first serves at over 100 miles an hour, a couple at 102. That's pretty fast. As you say, she's quite small, but she's 5'6" and a half. It's not quite, she looks shorter than she is, but she's got her hands full right now. Yes. What's been happening with Natalie Tauziat, I think, is that she suddenly had nothing more to lose. She got a little bit of fire going in there because she was had a certain amount of pride still lurking. She sort of fought her way back into the match, and now she's got really determined because she realizes she's holding her own. She's also started to get into the net more, and she's got a very good volley. She's angled off and some very good volleys, and also drop shotted some. Well, she had to go for it. Forehand does flatten out a little bit on her, and I think everybody's found this year at this tournament that if their timing is just marginally off, the ball flies off their racket. Difference in Arantxa from half an hour ago. She won the first set in 24 minutes and was almost winning too easily. When you're winning that easily, you don't really know what the real competition is. get a little nervous when the opposition starts to play better. Great backhand volley. Trouble for Tauziat is that she has to actually take some big chances to get into the net. From Arantxa Sanchez Vicario. She has chased down just a ton of these short balls, and every time she's got there, this time actually Natalie at least was sort of ready for it to come back, but it was the first time it came cross-court to her, so Tauziat couldn't do anything. So now a tie break. As I said, they've played seven times before, and only once has she taken Arantxa to a tie break, and that was quite a few years ago. That looks, that tiebreak record looks pretty much in Sanchez Vicario's favor. Going to win that battle. Let's see if we can have a better look. Certainly looked as if it was just out, and then some great shots after that. John Formbaum, she was very strict there. The net, but poking a bit at the backhand volley. She's got very tight. Thinking of tie breaks, the last tie break that she won was just a week and a bit ago in Canada, in Montreal, when she beat Steffi Graf 7-6 in the third set in an unbelievable match. Steffi had four match points at 5-3. Three, 98 mile an hour first serve. Not as fast as some of the others. Arantxa seeded number two in both singles and doubles. That volley was almost too easy. You know, you react to the difficult balls, you just do what your instinct determines, and suddenly you're so relieved to get an easy ball. Sometimes take your eye off it. Well, this one she moves right in. Good tough low volley, closes in on that one, and hits a pretty determined forehand volley. Needed that the shot before. A long way down still, Tauziat, 4-1. The best forehand that Arantxa Sanchez Vicario has hit for a while. She does have these tremendous passing shots, but she started to get tentative on her forehand. Turns her body, hooks around that ball. sometimes when she gets tight, she can't really drive through the forehand. Rolls up the back of the ball and her body weight goes a little backwards. She can't quite get her weight into the ball. Actually, this is a good match for her. She needed some good competition, but against somebody who she really can't lose to, I feel. It's famous last words to say that somebody's not going to lose to somebody at this tournament, especially in tie breaks. We've seen some great tennis on this court today. When the matches get close on this grandstand, the atmosphere gets terrific. Tauziat are doing just the right thing. Playing aggressively, keeping coming into the net. A very quick correction there by the umpire. Not too much of a complaint by Arantxa either on that, so I guess it was the correct call. Tremendous, takes a chance on the return, just nails this overhead. So now she has set point. Five straight points in a row. From 5-2 down, Natalie Tauziat is serving for the second set. Arantxa Sanchez-Vicario at her very best, it's when she's down and in trouble. She can always dig a little deeper and find some great shot. This is Sanchez-Vicario not looking all that happy there. Just had a sort of weird slip there. I think she's right, but just lost her footing, but she came down under control. She had a good shot at that backhand passing shot, but Arantxa was there, so how quickly things change. It's Arantxa with match point. Sanchez-Vicario knowing how to to convert that into a win. Good effort for her. I think that will have been a match to give her some confidence. She played really well, and then although she got a little nervous, she still managed to win. So that's it from the grandstand. Let's go back and see what's happening on the stadium court.
Happened, and ladies and gentlemen, the feat of John McEnroe. John, let's talk for a moment. Oh, we got 20 minutes.
Yeah,
or so.
I want to thank Richard Krajicek for this opportunity. Number one, thanks a lot for all those beautiful serves and the tiebreaker.
So Pete Sampras serving notice today, right?
Have I turned into a tomato yet? That's
my
only question.
You are fairly red, almost as red as the top half of you.
I like Sampras, Courier, and anyone else. Just get me out of this position.
You're a good sport. Let's go down to John Frankel now in the studio. John?
All right, who would ever call
no
John
one call
McEnroe
me a liar.
Headstrong? Alex O'Brien today on Casey Austin and Bill McAtee.
First game, first set, and we're at deuce with Gabriela Sabatini serving. These two have played only once before. That was at Wimbledon this year in the round of 32. Gabriela won 6-4, 6-1 against Meredith McGrath.
Game.
Sabatini.
First game.
So Sabatini holds to start the match against McGrath, who comes in as the number 32 player in the world, and Gabriela Tracy is the number 8 seed, 24 years old, born in Argentina, of course, and now lives in Key Biscayne, Florida. Quarterfinalist here the last 2 years. Currently ranked number 10 on the tour. Match record in singles, 28-13 this year. Champion in 1990, has made it as far as the quarterfinals the last 3 years. 11th appearance in the U.S. Open for Sabatini, and a career record of 40-9 here. Meredith McGrath is 23 years old. Grown up in Michigan, 5'7". She's playing in her fourth U.S. Open, currently ranked number 32. Two titles, Tracy, in 1994.
That's right. She won her first title of her career this year in Oklahoma City, won over Brenda Schultz, and then she won her second title in Eastbourne on grass, beat Navratilova in the quarters, Basugi in the semis, and Harvey Wild in the finals. That was a huge tournament for her.
There's that head-to-head meeting at Wimbledon.
That was right after McGrath had won Eastbourne.
Look, look,
Meredith's best showing in a Grand Slam was last year at Wimbledon when she made it to the round of 16.
Bill, this year? I would say that would be her best surface because she is an all-court player, likes to come into the net. WTA Comeback Player of the Year. Received that award Monday night.
As you mentioned, a great doubles player.
She has 5 doubles titles this year. She's won on the tour. Most of the time plays with Patty Fendick, has won 3 of those titles with Fendick, 1 with Sanchez, Vicario, and 1 with Nayland.
Patty Fendick, of course, that tremendous match today against Mary Jo Fernandez. That grandstand court was really rocking this afternoon. That was maybe the best match of the tournament thus far, that along with Becker and Rinnenberg opening night.
Came down to the wire, 7-6, 7-4 in the tiebreak.
15-30. Sabatini looking for the early break.
What a shot!
Drops in.
Gabriela took all the pace off this, just went for the angle. Look at that racket head, just whips it with such a loose wrist. Really has such great hands, could do so much with the ball. Heavy, heavy slice, all the way to heavy, heavy topspin.
Two break points.
Sabatini.
So the early service break to Gabriela Sabatini, and she leads 2-love to start the match. And other scores from day three.
Night three at the U.S. Open features two of men's tennis' best athletes. Michael Chang has been on fire. The number 6 seed here at the National Tennis Center is one of the most dynamic players on the men's tour. His exceptional quickness on the court makes his game one of the most exciting and energetic in the field of 100 Spain's Conchita Martinez. So pull up a seat and join us for an evening of open tennis on USA. Welcome to the night session of day 3 of the US Open. No need to make plans. There's plenty of nightlife right here at Flushing Meadows. At the National Tennis Center, there is entertainment, excitement, and a full evening of tennis ahead. And we'll find out who will survive into the next round. Rain has threatened here as the winds kicked up slightly. The temperature's in the mid-70s. The forecast right now, a 35% chance of rain, but we hope to dodge that to get in some great tennis here on day 3. Tonight, our featured match, Michael Chang, the 5th seed, against Malavia Washington. I'm John Frankel in the USA Network studios, and welcome. We have got an exciting evening of tennis in store, featuring a much-anticipated rematch of agility and athleticism. Michael Chang versus Malavia Washington. Chang has had a terrific year. He has won 5 tournaments in all, including Philadelphia, Hong Kong, Atlanta, and most recently, Cincinnati. He faces Malavia Washington, a player who's had an up-and-down career. At times, he can be a real force. At other times, he has struggled. But here at the Open, 2 years ago, in the round of 16s, these two players met. Grandstand court, a night match, just like tonight's will be. Chang won the first set, 6-2. It's rare that one of these two players can't chase down a ball. Everything seems to get returned. Washington turned it on, showing his versatility, coming to net and taking the next two sets, 6-2, 6-3. As the match moved into the wee hours, Michael Chang came back to win it, 6-3, 6-1 in 5 sets. These two players have met 7 times in their career, dating back to when they were both juniors in the 18 and under in 1987. Both cracked the top 6, including some other big names, including no bigger than Pete Sampras, who was then number 6. Also tonight, we will feature Conchita Martinez, the number 3 seeded player on the women's side of the draw. Some of you might remember that she reached the quarterfinal round in 1991, but you'll best remember her for having won Wimbledon this past summer. Martinez faces Nicole Arendt in the second round matchup on the stadium court. As for this man, Pincha Sanchez Vicario, the number 2 seed, also in action today on the grandstand against Natalie Tauziat of France. Arantxa Sanchez Vicario won in 6-2, 7-6. Also on the grandstand, 9th seeded Mary Jo Fernandez against Patty Fendick. Here's some of the highlights from that one. It was not an easy flight through to the 3rd round for Mary Jo Fernandez. She likes to stay on the baseline. Fendick would like to work her way to the net. Even when she did, Mary Jo seemed to have an answer. However, Fernandez struggled with her first serve, getting in just a little more than half. And Fendick was able to take advantage, forcing a 3rd and final set, which then went to a tiebreak. On match point, Fernandez made a rear appearance at the net. The serve and volley, 6-2, 2-6, 7-6, beating her good friend, Patty Fendick. 8-seeded Gabriela Sabatini was up on the stadium court against Meredith McGrath. Here are some of the highlights from that one. Sabatini thirsty for a win after her long drought. Remember, she won here in 1990. Her opponent, Meredith McGrath, this long point indicative of the match. 2 hours and 13 minutes. McGrath had 67 unforced errors, but put it all together in the second set and took it in a tiebreak. The third set was all Sabatini. The drop. And the chase. Sabatini advances 6-4, 6-7, 6-1. Some other results from around the matches today. Fifth seeded Kimiko Date was a winner easily, 6-love, 6-2. Leila Meschke, who a year ago knocked out Jennifer Capriati, was a winner in straight sets, beating 14 seeded Anke Huber, 2-2. Natalia Medvedeva was a winner in three sets, knocking out 16 seed Amy Frazier, seated here for just the first time. Taking a look at the draw on the women's side, Gabriela Sabatini has the chance to face Gigi Fernandez. The winner of tonight's match between Conchita Martinez and Nicole Arendt are also in this part of the draw. Mary Jo Fernandez and Arantxa Sanchez Vicario could meet as they move through the rest of this tournament. Stay with us here on USA. Coming up on the stadium court, third-seeded Conchita Martinez and Nicole Arendt, right here on USA. Today's coverage of the 1994 U.S. Open. They're filing in to the National Tennis Center for some great tennis tonight. Remember, coming up, it'll be Michael Chang against Malavia Washington. But right now, let's go out to the stadium for Wimbledon champ Conchita Martinez against Nicole Arendt. Your announcers, Ted Robinson and Tracy Austin.
Thanks, John. And here it's one game apiece in the first set. Conchita Martinez at the bottom of your screen. And a net lefty Nicole Arendt winning the point to make it love 30.
Nicole Arendt, a big serve and volley player, likes to play aggressively, get into the net whenever she can. Conchita Martinez, she seems to do well against those lefty serve and volleyers like Martina Navratilova in the finals of Wimbledon. And Conchita continuing this summer to come into the net, finishing off points. She did that a lot in that final at Wimbledon, Ted. I think that surprised Martina as well as a lot of other people. She came in to the net that much. In Barcelona, Spain.
Four titles this year for Conchita Martinez, including Wimbledon and the Italian Open. And jumped to number three.
One at Hilton Head and at Stratton Mountain. She's won two titles on clay, one on grass and one on hard. Can play on any surface now.
40-30. Now I call Nicole Arendt a veteran on the tour.
Nicole Arendt seems to play the top seeds here on night matches on USA Network. A few years ago, played Monica Seles. Last year, lost to Mary Pierce here in a night match.
This is the first ever meeting between these two.
Singles record 17 and 13. Nicole Arendt, 13 tournaments. All of them have been on either hard courts or grass. She prefers a faster surface. Chose to play none on clay, which of course is slower. Got up to net quickly. Was able to hit that ball before it went below the net. beautiful volleyer. Technique, very good. She's a very good doubles player. Deep shot, sees that Conchita is way behind the baseline. Nicole Arendt takes advantage of that, hits the volley out of the air. Conchita Martinez back about 6 feet, able to line up on that return of serve, made it low, set up this shot. What a backhand. Whips it, full swing.
Suddenly, Nicole Arendt has come to the end of her road. And it's starting to rain.
Quiet, please. Quiet, please. Thank you.
Just tips the net. Nicole Arendt acts quickly, holds there, she pushes it right down the line. Saves a match point.
I'm sure Martinez is there going, come on, serve, it's raining.
Exactly. Let's get this thing over before it starts to pour. Much Nicole Arendt can do with that except just hit it up. A few too many unforced errors. Couldn't convert on the break points. Really has to be pleased with her play tonight.
Don't forget Michael Chang and Malavia Washington still to come here on Stadium Court. Night three of the U.S. Open will continue from New York City on USA.
Sabatini, the 8th seed, facing Meredith McGrath. McGrath would lose in three sets, but before she did, she pulled off some heroics. Just catching the line on that one for our sharpshooter shot of the day. Right now, Michael Chang. It's open. The event beginning to take shape. The early rounds will certainly toughen players as they stretch to reach their peak form. Another beautiful day here at the National Tennis Center as we get set to play again. The playing conditions absolutely perfect with temperatures in the mid-70s. Welcome to our USA Network studios. I'm John Frankel. Last night, another night of great tennis here, including the third seed on the women's side, Conchita Martinez, the Wimbledon champion, facing Nicole Arendt. Martinez didn't struggle too much on the stadium court, winning in straight sets 6-3, 6-3. Also, six-seeded Michael Chang defeated Malavia Washington. It took four sets and a tiebreak in that last one, but Chang will advance as Washington goes home. We'll have complete highlights and details of that match coming up, so stay with us. Today, seeded sixth here, she'll be in action as well today on the stadium court. We will talk about her as well. She grew up on the courts of California. If she's to advance, however, she'll face one of the great veterans here, Pam Shriver, who was a finalist in 1978. Off action, number one seed Steffi Graf, 10-seeded Zina Garrison-Jackson. Those two could meet if they advance. Jana Novotna and Thomas Muster, the 13th seed on the men's side. Stay with us here on USA. We've got a great day of action and some terrific hats, too. We'll be back.
David Mercer.
Thanks very much, Bill, and good morning, everybody. Zina Garrison-Jackson out here, seated number 10, playing a young lady from Argentina, Paola Suarez, who's playing in the Open for the very first time. It's one game all in the first set. And as you saw there, 15 love on the Garrison-Jackson serve. Very unusual start to this match, which we'll tell you about after this point. That unusual start, after 2 points, Zina Garrison went up to the umpire and pointed out that her shoes were disintegrating around her. Brand new shoes, collapsed totally, had to sprint back to the locker room and get a new pair. And since it's an all-British commentary team, we better admit that it's a pair of British shoes, but not, I suspect, made in Britain. Most of them made out in the Far East these days.
It was amazing because she disappeared. The whole flap came off the bottom, but, you know, it's a long sprint back to the dressing room.
Not surprisingly, Zina came back and served a double fault and dropped a serve, but she broke back immediately. Zina playing in the Open for the 15th time, 30 years of age, from Houston in Texas, twice a semi-finalist here, in 1988 when she lost to Gabriela Sabatini, and the following year when she lost to Martina Navratilova. And there's her record this year, 19 wins, 11 losses.
Well, she's had a mixed year, really, this year. She's hasn't played as well as a normal, consistent standard, but she had a beautiful Wimbledon, and there she beat Arantxa in three long, drawn-out hard sets before losing to Gigi Fernandez. So she is certainly capable, on a given occasion, to rise to really the top level of the game. She's chosen pretty much to stay back in this match, and to me that's an odd choice.
And let's have a look at a young lady appearing here in Flushing Meadows for the first time. 18 years of age, from Buenos Aires, 5'7". She was a finalist in the French Open Juniors a couple of years ago. This is her first year on the tour, and that's a good record. 15 wins, 10 losses. Got to the semi-final in Prague as a qualifier. Lost to Amanda Kurtzer.
But to be honest, most of those wins were in qualifying runs, but her ranking has gone up from starting the year at 200, and it went as high as 100, so she's verging on breaking through. She also has very nice fluid shots, as most of the Argentinian players do. That one she wrapped around a racket, but that's why it's a strange choice for Zina to be playing the game that she really is least happy with, the baseline game, against somebody who obviously is really a master of ground strokes. Anybody coming from Argentina really is.
Advantage to Garrison-Jackson to take a 2-1 first set lead. The match has actually been in progress for 17 minutes. They've been playing, though, for 12.
Oh. Martinez never played Paola before, although she has played her in a doubles match. And when a young player comes along and she's ranked low, the top players don't get much opportunity to even scout them. It has to be pretty much word of mouth. It's one of the great things about the Grand Slams, having a big draw. You get to see a lot more players.
Paola playing in her third Grand Slam. She lost in the first round of the French and at Wimbledon. Qualified for the French, direct entry for Wimbledon and here. Showing us she can cover the court pretty quickly.
Tremendous get there. It was really worth the hassle. It was almost as if she decided. See, this wasn't a very good volley there. She squeezes this one out, Zina, but she doesn't really recover. She thinks she's won the shot. And really, because Paola was looked as if she wasn't going to bother to run, it was worth the run.
So all three games in this first set have gone against the serve, and it's young Paola Suarez who leads 2-1. Now, of course, one of the great things about the first week of a Grand Slam is that the top names are in action all over the courts, and out on court 17 is a man who reached the quarterfinals last year. I'll have to tell him that I'm Welsh, not English.
I was thinking the same thing, but I was going to stay out of that.
But we're both Brits.
This has actually been a really very nice match. It's so interesting watching Zina. She does so many different things with the ball. Every ball she hits has a purpose, and most of it's extremely intelligent. One thing I just don't know is why she still hasn't found a way into the net more. She's only been in about less than a dozen times, and she's been pretty successful when she's been there.
And just an example of some of the fine rallies in this young 18-year-old.
Not a point.
Showing us why she was one of the best juniors in the world a couple of years ago.
She really has all the shots. She's got a pretty good serve. She can play at the net. And we've seen her hitting a lot of ground strokes. Moving reasonably well, having a bit of trouble reaching Zina's extreme cross-court forehands, though.
She takes a long backswing, and if Garrison-Jackson can attack her, put her under a pressure, then the ground strokes may break down a little. Still has double break point, though. Get it back to 5-4.
Getting to that volley. It's interesting because I think for somebody who's 18, who these days seems like quite a mature age, but for a lot of these young players it's just they're quite new in it. I thought she handled this shot very well, but right here she almost didn't think that the ball was coming back and took her eye off the volley. She knew she had the whole court.
On the line, and the break back is secured. 5-4 then to Zina Garrison in the first set. Closed out that second set, but Zina Garrison-Jackson could close out her match with Paola Suarez. This was match point.
And Paola Suarez fell apart a little bit. She looks very promising. She's relatively inexperienced and was fun to watch.
6-4, 6-3. Steffi Graf's up now on the grandstand. We'll be back.
Suddenly, early in the third set. Here, though, Well, things are happening quite normally. Steffi Graf, Virginia Wade, has blown through five games here with Sandra Cacic and has finally reached a deuce point, the first one of the set.
Having had two set points, the first time she's shown any signs of making any sort of errors. WTA is going to have the same sort of fortune as Carbacher out there.
That's right.
Although Steffi has a legitimate bad back. Mm-hmm. But it's, I mean, she's came out so explosively. Steffi started off serving an ace at about 103 miles an hour. Has been served, that's served five aces, all way up in pace.
First five games of this set, Cacic won only 7 points, but she has played a better game here. And as Virginia just mentioned, this is not what you would consider necessarily a pushover. This is the number 41 ranked player, 10 days shy of her 20th birthday.
And she's a pretty competent player. They played actually for the first time in Montreal a couple of weeks ago in the second round there. She got four games, but she is just being absolutely outgunned by Steffi. Steffi is phenomenal so far in this match. It's amazing, you know, the crowd just rolled right into here before the match started. There's no space for all the people who wanted to leave the empty court over there in the stadium.
Cacic saves another set point.
Sandra Cacic has been in the quarterfinals of three tournaments this year, including wins over Sokova, McNeil, Gigi Fernandez. And in Stratton, she did well, only losing to Sanchez, Vicario in three sets.
Rolling on now, hard to believe, 25 years old.
Steffi being like the perfect build for an athlete, 5'9", 132. Body fat is probably so low, it's negligible.
If you were going to craft on a computer, other than the number one rank, the number one build physique for a player, Virginia, is that it?
Yeah, definitely, for any sort of athlete. I mean, she's so fleet of foot. 11th appearance here. She's won this tournament three times. Hasn't fed all that well at the US Open. For somebody as good as she is. She won it last year, but the three previous years, she struggled. That woke him up.
Converts a set point, and in just 23 minutes she has closed out Sandra Cacic in the first set.
Steffi Graf, of course, the supposed winner, or definitely the favorite for this tournament, but she does show vulnerability in these Grand Slam tournaments, especially this year, the French, Wimbledon. And then she showed some nerves in the final of Montreal when she had four match points against Arantxa Sanchez Vicario, the second of which was an absolute sitter.
Sandra Cacic hits a winner, and that draws some encouragement from the crowd. Native of Joliet, Illinois, and we mentioned in 10 days she will celebrate her 20th birthday. Now plays her tennis out of Florida.
whole family is involved in tennis, coached by her father, Tony. She needs to take a few chances and hope for a little luck here. Of somebody getting demolished, but they also want to see a little bit more of the match. It's a certain pleasure in watching somebody as good as Steffi just playing brilliant tennis and whitewashing somebody, but you also prefer to see a little competition. A slow ace at 97.
I used to wonder, Virginia, whether all these easy matches that Graf would have in early rounds here helped her or hurt her, and I guess she's played so many years now that that's probably a moot point.
I think they hurt her
a little bit.
I think it's quite difficult for somebody like Steffi to just cruise through so many matches, and then suddenly you get to a very tight situation and you're not used to handling it. You know, the other thing that happens to Steffi, she's winning so easily, but she doesn't take the opportunity to experiment with some adaptations to her game. Watching Arantxa play her match yesterday, which she was playing so well in, she was trying everything. She was coming up to the net. She was using the whole variety of tennis shots.
Do you think that has hurt Steffi in some of the big matches, even the ones that she's lost through the years here?
No question.
The Sabatini final.
No question. She's very reluctant to adapt and play a game that isn't, that she isn't that comfortable with. And in a, for somebody as good as she is, she plays tennis, tough matches, in quite a difficult way. You know, the number of times she hits the really penetrating forehand and the ball pops up in the air and she won't go in and knock it off.
We're going to get you an update on the Yvonne Lendl retirement from his match today as soon as this game is complete. The edge there of the shadows being cast halfway across the court. That can't help the receiver right now, then, can it? Serving from sunlight into shade.
Oh, it's very difficult because it's extremely bright and quite dark in the shadow.
On the grandstand, Steffi Graf is firmly in command against American Sandra Cacic. And now let's get an update on the Yvonne Lendl situation as we go to the stadium court at Linda Pence.
Lindsay Davenport, who is the highest seeded American player, and she's playing a fellow American, Pam Shriver. Lindsay Davenport, though, is really on a rocket in the rankings. She's done a great job over the last year.
That's right. She's really had a great year. Won the first tournament of the year in Brisbane, Australia, on hard courts. In Lucerne, she won that as well on clay courts. Got to the quarterfinals at Wimbledon right after her high school graduation. Didn't miss the high school graduation. But she did pull a calf muscle earlier this summer in San Diego, had a default in the quarterfinals, so hasn't played a WTA Tour event since then.
Her opponent today, Pam Shriver, and Pam Shriver has been here before, obviously. Is this the kind of match that Lindsay Davenport wants?
Pam Shriver is going to be a very tough opponent. She's been playing better this summer, and her serve has been going pretty hard. And, of course, Pam Shriver feels very comfortable here. First time she played in this tournament, 1978, she was only 16 years old, lost to Chris Evert in the finals, beat Martina Navratilova in the semis. So she feels very comfortable, has played before all this many people many times and in this stadium many times, whereas Lindsay, this is her first time in the stadium.
One of the highlights of the U.S. Open a year ago was watching Lindsay Davenport over on the grandstand in the middle Sunday in the quarterfinals against Gabriela Sabatini. Lindsay won the first set in a tiebreak, and then Sabatini came back in very tight second and third sets to win 6-4, 6-4. But I think that's when a lot of people first became aware of Lindsay Davenport. There on the right, and Pam Shriver on the left.
Lindsay Davenport also won the junior title here at the U.S. Open in 1992. That was played on the grandstand, so she has played, obviously, here in front of a lot of people and obviously all over the world in big stadiums. But this stadium is a little bit different.
Her fourth U.S. Open appearance already. She played here as a 15-year-old in 1991. She lost in the first round in the main draw. She is seeded sixth. The world ranking is number seven. 18 years old. Born in Palos Verdes, California, which has produced a few pretty good tennis players, including the lady to my right, Tracy Austin, also Pete Sampras, known back then simply as Petey.
Don't mention that anymore.
He doesn't like that very much. Pam Shriver to serve.
15 low.
There's Pam Shriver, now 32 years old, who lives in Baltimore.
Pam's the oldest player in the tournament.
30 low.
Zina Garrison, right around 30. Currently ranked 52. Been as high as number three. The last time she was number three was June of 1988.
16th U.S. Open appearance. She lost in the first round last year.
Still amazing to me that the first time she played here, that was her best result in any Grand Slam. She was so young. 16 years old.
And an ace, a love game from Pam Shriver, and we're underway on the stadium.
Steffi Graf receiving in this game, but has a chance to close it out on their stadium court. They're on serve early, and we'll be going right back to the Shriver-Davenport match. And here's Steffi Graf trying to close it out.
Another good serve from Sandra. Been more big first serves in this match. This court has played reasonably slowly, so it's quite impressive to see such powerful serving from both Sandra as well as Steffi. It's been very much a matter of statistics, this match for Steffi. 26 winners, 7 losers. One of the winners was at the net. The only time she came in once.
That might be one more than many matches that she's won here in the past.
She did come in of her own choice. She wasn't brought in by a drop shot. Actually, it probably is good for Steffi to have some good, easy matches because...
Oh. Well, if she's trying to play through the back pain she has, she's getting daily chiropractic treatments. You're right, it probably doesn't need any more time out here than necessary.
That's right.
Now we reach the first match point.
Mm-hmm.
One more piece of litter falling down from the top of the stadium.
Potential is for a quarterfinal match between Graf and Davenport.
Absolutely, I was just thinking that, but Zina Garrison should be her next opponent in another round, not next round, but the following one. And then her half of Pierce and Novotna.
Too many years we've seen that, just too good.
It's a tremendous pleasure watching Steffi when she's in full flight, just walloping those forehands for winners all over the place. Second match point.
Spoken during the Open so far about how a guy like Becker at 26 or 27 now starts to get a little old on the men's circuit. Graf is 25. How would you phase? Is she middle age?
Well, I think
advancing years.
She sometimes feels that she's been out here playing a long time and she doesn't want to go on playing that much more. But you know, she has such a desire for the game. She just loves to play. I always remember the one year she couldn't play. Continue that thought. The one year she was hurt and couldn't play at Wimbledon, she came over for the weekend to watch. You know, she's so compelled by this game, and every match she goes on, she has this compelling desire and determination to win. So I don't think her interest in the game has waned at all. I think she's a little more philosophical when she does lose, though.
Well, that was the match in most people's minds right there, but Steffi was long. On the stadium, Lindsay Davenport has gone up a break in the first set. And we'll be going right back to that match at the conclusion of this.
So it's fourth match point, and you know, one of the objectives for Steffi in these easy matches to me seems to be to finish them on the first match point, because in the last year or so she's got a little sloppy with that match point situation. And here we are again, it's taking her a few.
Well, for Graf, this is a long match, 55 minutes. But she's on to the third round, where she will meet either Australian Nicole Bradke or Czech Radka Bobkova. They're playing their second round match right now as well.
Good stuff there from Steffi. She just came out knowing that she wanted to win the match in a hurry. She was ready for it. You know, sometimes you feel that people are just not quite psyched when they get on court. She was absolutely psyched from the first moment. As I said, I think she took too many chances to win that last point. It would have been good for her and her own psychological makeup to finish the match off on the first match point. But I mean, she was in brilliant form.
Well, Steffi Graf is on to the third round. We'll be coming back to the Pam Shriver-Lindsay Davenport match when USA's coverage of the U.S. Open continues from New York.
You'll never get...
15 love.
I think one of the things you have to admire about Lindsay Davenport is the way she's handled her career thus far. She's taken her time, tried to enjoy high school, and gone through things in a very meticulous way, I think, in order not to deprive herself of her teenage years. And with the controversy around Jennifer Capriati, I think that's a very good thing. And probably help down the line.
Yeah, one thing people don't know, though, is that Lindsay did go to correspondence course her junior year. And she moved from Palos Verdes to Marietta. She was taking correspondence, wasn't in school, then decided to change and go back to school.
15 all.
Better than Lindsay Davenport was at 14. Lindsay Davenport didn't have a choice. She wouldn't have been ready to play in the pros, but you're right. It might have helped her that her talent seemed to come to fruition later on. Jennifer was definitely ready physically to play. She's a big girl. And her game proved it. Got to the finals of her first tournament.
So 30 all.
This week has been interesting for Pam Shriver with her rackets, because in her first match she said three of her rackets broke, not the strings, but the actual rackets when she hit a shot. So she was down to one racket when she beat Beate Reinstadler in the first round, so she had five more shipped out. Pam trying to pull her skirt down. She's serving against the wind right now. Her serve, always her biggest weapon. So tough to break her when she was serving well.
Crowd thought it was an ace.
And I think Pam's just teasing, saying, hey, that serve felt so good. Couldn't you just let that one go? And a little bit too far back behind the service line there to hit that volley. You need to be a little closer to the net.
Deuce. Davenport is able to put it away.
Another set match point, excuse me, for Lindsay Davenport.
Match point number two.
Pam Shriver choosing to stay back on that second serve, showing the respect of Davenport's return a serve. Usually Pam comes in on every serve. There was a third serve, she'd come in on that one as well.
So in 53 minutes, Lindsay Davenport, the number six seed from California, advances to the third round over Pam Shriver, 6-1, 6-2.
Lindsay Davenport playing very solid tennis from the baseline and at the net. I'm sure Pam Shriver's going to be disappointed with her play, especially ending on a double fault. Not a good way to go out.
So now let's take a look at this portion of the women's singles draw, starting with Steffi Graf, who was the winner today over Sandra Cacic.
I think that she'll probably play Bradke, who is the former Nicole Provost from Australia. That's her married name. I think she'll get through that and face Garrison-Jackson. And I think she'll move on into the quarters in that top half of the draw. And Lindsay Davenport plays Mana Endo next. That's a big upset there. She beat Allard, because Allard beat Davenport at the French Open this year.
Julie Allard from France.
And at the top, Amanda Kutzer could play the winner of Werdell and Marianne DeShwart. I think Kutzer will get through that and have to meet up against Davenport. I think Davenport will get through there.
So a few more autographs for the 18-year-old as she moves on to the third round, 1 and 2.
Hi, darling.
Seems to be a terrific tennis player.
Pro tennis was more like a dream, not a reality. When it did happen, I was like, well, this is great, you know, this is something I've dreamed for.
First thing I want to talk about is your high school graduation. Tell me what it was like.
It was a lot of fun. It was something that I really wanted to be there for, and, you know, high school was a pretty big part of my life, and I definitely said I did not want to miss that, so it was great. It was pretty nervous, though. You know, you have to walk out, and it was really exciting, you know, to see all your friends be so happy and to graduate and to know that you accomplished something besides tennis. It was a great feeling. That's cute. Not on me. I love the Limited.
What'd you wear on your graduation gown?
What? Oh, just a skirt and just like this little dress. Mine was so big. It's like, they ordered it for someone like 6'5". It was so huge.
Is there ever a time that you felt like you were a different kid? I mean, let's face it, you've got this incredible tennis ability and your friends. I mean, did you ever think, yeah, I'm really special?
You know, being around high school helped me a lot because, you know, some of my friends couldn't afford to go to the movies or we'd have to go to fast food. And so I realized how lucky I am. It's very uncomfortable still to be recognized and some of the stuff. And, you know, maybe I'll get a little more comfortable with it, but I've never thought of myself as special, just maybe fortunate.
We've got to buy you sunglasses.
I'm serious.
No way.
Oh no.
Let's see.
Here we go again. You ready? We'll do it fast.
I don't know. I'm very, very shy.
They're nice. Those are nice.
This is getting me tired.
Not great.
No, they look more cool. They look not happy, but run away.
Yes. Natasha, do I get these?
She's making this a nightmare. Is it never wear these in public?
No one's helping. Okay, I'm getting these. Period, the end.
She made it to the
okay, yes! We're out of here. Been here an hour.
One last.
Oh, no!
So these are better.
Yeah. Okay. So U.S. Open, I'll be stylish in my new glasses.
You're going to New York. I mean, you got to have style.
Okay.
I say the U.S. Open to you. What's the first thing that comes to your mind?
Oh, gosh. It's so exciting there. You know, the fans are great. You know, it's really nice to play a big tournament in your home country, and the fans really get into the tennis there. And it's crazy. You know, they're making noise, and it really takes a lot to win matches there. Last year, I really had my first big match. I lost to Sabatini in the fourth round. The crowd was so into it and jumping up and down, and, you know, it was a feeling I'll never forget, even though I lost.
Lindsay Davenport wears many hats and knows happiness is a combination. She's managed a balance between life as a teenager and that of a budding tennis star.
Yeah, very balanced.
I have a variety of things that I do to keep me entertained and to have fun, and I know I have pretty good perspective on what's important in my life. Winning a tennis match, if I don't win it, it's fine. You know, I'm not gonna, you know, cry for days, or, you know, it's not gonna change my life.
The shadeless Lindsay Davenport joins Tracy Austin now in our studio.
Lynn, why, when you're watching this, are you putting a towel over your head? Oh my gosh, I don't want to see this.
That's embarrassing.
But you've done this many times now.
I don't like watching myself on TV. It's kind of embarrassing. It's just like when you hear your voice. It's so uncomfortable, I think.
But you've had a great summer. I moved in a couple of days with Natasha Zvereva into your own apartment. What did that mean to you? Just a couple of days before you came here to the U.S. Open.
It's been a real exciting kind of summer. We got our own apartment in Newport Beach, and we moved in about 3 days before we both left. And so for 3 days, we had no furniture, and we slept on the floor. All we had was a refrigerator and a microwave. But it was a lot of fun, and I can't wait to get back and furnish it.
Well, tell us about your first year and a half as a pro. I know when you said when you came onto the circuit, it was a little difficult for you because in the juniors you had a lot of friends. You didn't make friends that easily at the beginning in the pros, but now you have a lot of good friends.
Yeah, I think it was really tough the first couple of months on the pro tour. You don't know many people, and it's really tough to really find some friends in the beginning. And it took me a while, and actually that's why I kind of delayed turning pro, because I didn't really enjoy it. And once I started meeting some people and having fun, you know, I turned pro, and now I love it. You know, I have a lot of friends on that I just love to be around. It makes it just the life so much more easy.
And looking back on the past year and a half, I mean, did you expect to rise in the rankings all the way up to number 7 this quickly?
No. I never knew, you know, where I was going to go or what I was going to do. And, you know, I've just kept, you know, improving and going higher and higher. And I know eventually it's going to stop or go down. So I'm just kind of preparing myself for that now.
Now, you keep improving. Looks like you have just about every part of the game. What possibly could you still improve?
Well, I definitely think I need to be a little bit faster. That is definitely that weakness that is exploited more when I play the top players. When I can't dictate play and they can move me around, I'm not really that good. So I really want to work on my speed and coming to net more and really volleying some more and being more comfortable at the net.
Now, looking forward in this tournament, you have possibly Amanda Klitzer in the fourth round and Graf in the quarters. Talk about those.
Yeah, I have the next couple of rounds are really tough. Third round, I could possibly play Hollard, who I've played in the last two Grand Slams.
I think she lost today.
Okay, then I don't play Hollard. No.
Endo.
I play Endo, okay. And then my draw after that is Kotzer, I believe, and that's very tough. She gets a lot of balls back and runs really well. And then, of course, Steffi. That's where, you know, I want to be so I can get a chance to play her.
Now, Graf? What about Graf?
Yeah. Steffi, I've played her twice this year and only two times, and both times, you know, I lost in two sets, but you really get, I get excited to play the top players, and when you get a chance to, you know, see where you're at compared to they are, and really to play Steffi, because she's by far the best, it's just, it'll be great if I could get there.
Okay, well done today. You still have those shades that you bought in that
I do, I'll bring them next time.
Okay, well done.
Thank you.
Back to you, John.
Okay, thanks very much, Tracy. Coming up next on the stadium court, probably without his sunglasses, ninth-seeded Todd.
Tonight on Stadium Court, it's the surge in the open third round. Agassiz continues to inch closer to living one of hers. At this year's French Open, Pierce reached her first Grand Slam final before bowing out to Arantxa Sanchez Vicario. Her quest to top that continues tonight on Stadium Court.
Of course, the runner-up at Wimbledon last year, Jana from the Czech Republic, of course, Czechoslovakia, and a split into the Czech Republic and the Slovak Republic, and her opponent comes from the Slovak Republic, and that's Karina Habsudova from Bratislava. Novotna at the near end serving has won the first set 6-2. She's 1-2 down in the second set on serve, but it's all been a bit of a struggle, really. It's taken 62 minutes to get this far. Jana's needed a little bit of treatment, an injury, we understand, to a toe. So although that first set sounds easy at 6-2, it really hasn't been easy. She was up a break right at the start of this set, lost it, and is now down 1-2. So it's not been the most convincing of performances, but then conditions actually on the outside courts are now very difficult. The wind has got up. It's beautiful and cool for the spectators and commentators alike, but the players would prefer a little less wind, I think. So Novotna levels at 2-2 in the second set, having won the first set 6-2. We're going to go next to the grandstand. Richie Renneberg, the conqueror of...
She is a fighter. She is tenacious. On the court, she is pure emotion. She conceals nothing. Fearfully serious, perhaps too serious, she has been on the cusp of a few big wins, but failed to finish the job. Last year at the 1993 U.S. Open, Mary had high hopes after breezing through the first three rounds. But then, Steffi Graf wiped Pierce off the court, 6-1, 6-love. A loss that still lingers in Mary's mind.
That match I will never forget because I remembered how I felt. You know, I felt very confident. I felt like I was playing really good. And I was very excited to play Steffi at night, center court. And I felt ready to play her for a good match. And I went out on the court, and everything I did, you know, didn't seem to work. And Steffi was just playing unbelievable. So, you know, I guess I learned to not go on the court and think I'm going to have an easy match or to be too confident, just to always be ready.
But 9 months later, she met Graf again. It was the semifinals of the 1994 French Open on clay, which she could claim was home turf due to her mother's heritage. Her first victory over Steffi Graf was one of those great moments in tennis. Never had her notoriously serious expression been so joyous. Though she eventually lost in the finals to Arantxa Sanchez Vicario, it's clear that Mary Pierce has arrived. She has effectively silenced the rumors that placed her under siege of the media upon her decision to pull out of Wimbledon earlier this summer. And the shadow of her controversial father is fading from public focus. He is still banished from all tournaments, and it appears that she has put that behind her. There were difficult times when he made her the most talked about woman in tennis, but the talk wasn't at all about tennis.
The media always tries to tell a good story, to see it exaggerated to the good or to the worst. And with my dad, it's always been the worst, I guess, because they basically saw mostly that. But, you know, if it wasn't for him, really, I probably wouldn't be here today because, you know, it's from my dad, I think, that I had the hard work ethic. You know, he worked me very hard in the beginning. You know, he was there every day and stayed all day long after I was on the court. So, you know, and he pushed me, so I don't think those things were really bad. He was very generous. Well, with my mom, you know, we've been together practically all my life, so I've spent most of my time with my mom. She's probably my best friend, and, you know, I feel very lucky to have a mom like her and a friend like her because, you know, she's helped me a lot. She's been there with me through the hard times and been able to talk to her and she's been able to support me, and I've been able to support her.
Pierce is now training with veteran tennis coach Nick Bollettieri, who, to his credit, has gotten some of the best tennis out of some other big names. Bollettieri has been working with Pierce on her physical conditioning and footwork, but her main concern has been mental strategy in a match.
I sort of decided that Mary was very simple on the court, and her dad a long time ago told her to hit the ball very, very hard and don't worry about it. So I sort of put it in a little plainer English. So I said, Mary, on the court, you're not a great thinker. In fact, if you overthink, it works against you.
Before, what we were trying to do is make me think a little bit more, because I would just go out and hit the ball and never think. And, you know, I would make a lot of mistakes, lose my concentration and things. So, you know, we tried to make me play a little bit slower, change the pace.
And that's sort of the philosophy that we have adopted for Mary to become a hitter and try to control the match, do a lot less thinking, and just sort of let her instincts take over.
He was totally right. My game is, you know, go out there, be relaxed. That's very important for me, to be relaxed, and so that I can think clearly in my mind. And just when the ball comes, you know, I have a feeling where I should hit it. And just to go with that feeling, that's when I play my best.
Her performance on the red clay of Roland Garros was like a dream. There is no doubt she had arrived at the top of her game.
It was great. Every day I woke up, I felt eager and ready to play. And you know, practice, I was getting great, and went out in the matches, and everything I did worked. I mean, every match I played, everything worked, so it's a dream come true.
Now she is no longer the girl of rumor and innuendo. She's the Hollywood starlet. She arrives in New York City full of glamour and grace. No longer is the talk about her father or Wimbledon. The talk is now about tennis, and Mary is dealing with that just fine.
I feel in my life a lot of things have changed, and you know, be on the court and also off the court. So that's made me kind of realize things more in everyday life and to enjoy things more, you know, not to take life so seriously. I don't really think so much of going out there that I have to win, you know. I just go out there and try my best and have fun, and you know, I've been doing a lot better since then.
You'll see Mary Pierce in her second round match tonight here at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on USA. Tennis throughout the grounds.
USA's coverage of the 1994 U.S. Open. Snoopy, an avid tennis fan, is enjoying the action at the 1994 U.S. Open along with all the rest of us here. Right now, let's go out to the stadium court with Barry McKay and Tracy Austin.
Nikova has already suffered a service break here in the second set to start it.
Bill McAtee along with Tracy Austin. We don't know where Snoopy is, but I assume high above the windy skies above the stadium. I've gotten word that Mary Pierce asked for some medicine earlier in the match, apparently not feeling too well, but is playing well.
Did you get a good look at it? Oh man, no, it's just like, if anything, like the service, you're gonna call that out. So, you just gonna go with his call?
No overrule. So love 15.
Just from some nerves, nervous stomach.
15 all. It was an odd time to go to the chair, by the way. I mean, up a break already and having won the first set, seemingly cruising through.
Well, she obviously, especially from what she said, felt that it was a clean winner. That one was right on both lines. Can't get better than that. She really does have a big forehand as well, Studenikova. She can topspin her backhand or hit a slice.
That's where Mary Pierce will win a lot of points, just from pure power.
Pure power, and when she has a chance to get set up, she's so lethal off of both sides, a lot like Lindsay Davenport, who played here on stadium court as well today.
That's wide.
40. When you get them on the run, they can't hit with that much power with the accuracy as well.
Studenikova now with an opportunity, break point, to even things up at one all here in the second set. Big point for Studenikova.
Misjudged it, mistimed it, hit a little early. Mary took a little pace off that ball, hit it with more top spin, 88 miles an hour.
Studnikova will have a second break opportunity. So to pick up on what you were saying earlier, the best way to play Mary is to try to move her around the court and not allow her to get set to hit.
Exactly. Now, of course, everybody would say, hey, that's how you play everybody. But she's so lethal with so much power. She can't hit that much power on the dead run.
Broken back.
And just moments ago out here on the grandstand, the number 12 seed, Wayne Ferreira. And the big forehand came to life for Ferreira. Wayne Ferreira over Marcelo Rios. And basically, Ferreira was just too tough in that third set. And so Ferreira moves into the third round. Back to you, Bill.
All right, Barry, thank you.
Thank you.
Moment of truth now for Mary Pierce. Second opportunity to serve out the match. And while we were away, the crowd gave these two women a nice ovation as they came to take the court here in the third set. There you see the time of the match, an hour and 46 minutes. Mary Pierce will wait for everyone to find their seat. You can almost hear what she's saying. Stay calm, stay focused, play your game.
Great way to start the game. Mary Pierce only losing her serve once in this third set. Thing. She moves on. You could tell mentally that she just said, hey, move on to the next point.
15 all.
Mary Pierce shaking her head because Studnikova just made a stab at that. Reacting late, didn't think it was going to come over.
You see her eyes go immediately to Nick Bollettieri in the player's box.
This is when it gets tight. Hook and serve, down 15-30. Mary Pierce has all the pressure on her. Number five player in the world playing against number 103. And when you're Studnikova here, you just want to keep hitting out. Play the same way that got you to this position. Match point for Mary Pierce. Nick Palatieri. He looks nervous.
About Mary in the August issue of Tennis Magazine, and she was quoted as saying, before, when people talked about me, it was always Mary Pierce, look what her dad did to her. All along I was hoping and waiting for the day when people would just say, there's Mary Pierce, look what she did on the tennis court. And what she did on the tennis court tonight was overcome great physical discomfort and a tough opponent and advance in the U.S. Open.
Mary Pierce held up very well under the pressure. She had a lot of pressure. She wasn't playing her best. She didn't feel her best. Had a stomach ache, but she came through when it was most important. Raised the level of her game.
Don't forget, coming up next on the stadium court, Andre Agassi and Guy Forget. A night at the Open on USA.
Great win. Did you expect it to be so tough?
Well, no, because I really didn't know what to expect, because I've never played her before, I never even seen her, I didn't know what she looked like. So that was kind of tough going into the match, not knowing what to expect, but, you know, she played really, really well and kept the ball deep.
Now, what was the problem with your stomach in the second set?
I don't know, I think I might have ate a little bit too soon before I came on. I just felt really, really full on my stomach, so.
Now, looking back this summer at the French Open, you got to the finals. Now, what was the effect on your tennis as well as on your personal life? What changed in your life after that?
Well, I mean, I guess a lot of more demands of myself, you know, being more in the public, and, you know, those kind of things are a little bit hard to adjust to, but I think I'm getting used to it.
Now, last year here, you seemed to hit a hard game all the time. Now you seem to have adjusted and mixed in some slices, some lobs, and yet at the same time, Nick Balotelli's been quoted as saying, I just want Mary to get up to the baseline and hit the ball as hard as she can.
No.
So how do you see those two?
Well, that's true. I mean, before, I really would just hit the ball without thinking. And, you know, now I'm trying to change the pace sometimes, you know, once in a while, so that the opponent doesn't get used to my hard shots. But, you know, I have to play my game, basically, and just play with my instincts.
So what's been the biggest change in the last year? Because your results have been just drastically better in the last year.
I think I'm just basically enjoying it more. I'm more relaxed when I'm out there. I'm not too worried that I have to win all the time just to give it my best.
Thanks, Mary.
Thank
Back
you.
To you, Ted Robinson.
You're getting set for the second match of the night program as Andre Agassi and Guy Forget will battle in a second-round men's singles match. There's something.
It's been another disappointing tournament for three-time Open champ Yvon Lendl. He was forced to retire in the third set of his match with Bernd Karbacher, but before succumbing to stiffness in his back, he won this ping-pong exchange at the net with our sharpshooter shot of the day. And stay with us. Agassi has taken the first set from Forget. Well, you can take the Long Island Railroad or the number 7 from Manhattan, take a walk on the boardwalk, and come join USA at the National Tennis Center, Flushing Meadows, Corona Park. We kick off Labor Day weekend with day 5 of the U.S. Open. A vacation for most, but hard work for the competitors here. It could be made easier by an absolutely spectacular day for tennis. Temperatures right at 70, the forecast sunny all day long for great tennis that'll take you right into the night. And it is a great day for ex-champions. Just a short while ago, Stefan Edberg, a winner here in 91 and 92, took to the court to practice a court that he has owned in the past. Stefan Edberg will be in action later on this morning up against Jeff Taranga. We will bring you plenty
of that action. Hello, everyone. I am John Frankel inside the USA studios. Lots of good tennis for you today as we